joining us for his take on Philippine shares and other Asian markets. Ken Wong of Eastspring Investments. Ken, thank you so much for joining us. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, so Ken, Sydney is on a new two-week lockdown. Malaysia just unveiled a fresh $36 billion stimulus package because it's extending its lockdown. Hong Kong banning passenger flights from the UK to stem the spread of the new COVID variant. Is it time to reprice the prospects of reopening and easing of restrictions in Asia as more countries experience rolling lockdowns?
There can be. I think specifically what the markets, initially were very optimistic is specifically with 2021's economic growth. And also at the same time, when we look at, earnings growth expectations throughout the region, they were, pointing to a very strong sort of growth for the share. But with that said, we're waiting for first half earnings to be reported to us. And then we'll see specifically what the guidance will be for the second half of the year for a lot of the companies here in Asia, whether they feel that, earnings growth can be sustainable. The fact is that, there are some countries which are now within lockdowns, and particularly when you still even look at the Philippines, Metro Manila area still is in still in lockdown. But still, with that said, the global economy, certain areas in the U.S. and China are definitely recovering very nicely, or has recovered quite nice already. So, it'll be interesting to see specifically with some of these other Asian countries what will happen. But we're sort of more cautiously optimistic that hopefully this will only be a short-term impact, and for the full fiscal year 2021. Earnings can still see an improvement as compared to 2020.
Mm-hmm. And what sort of growth are you looking at for earnings for Asia this year?
Well, in general, if you look at the consensus, earnings throughout Asia is sort of hovering anywhere between 20 some odd percent to even 40-50%. Look at Philippines for earnings growth for this year because of such negative earnings growth we saw last year. This year we could see potentially 50+%. Next year, of course, without that low base effect, we're probably back down to sort of in the 20s or low 30s in terms of earnings growth. But for this year so far, that's where we're at. But again, like I mentioned earlier, we'll see what happens in the next 4 to 6 weeks or so when companies start to report their first half numbers, and to see whether or not those specific guidance for the full year remains, or potentially we might have to dial down some of those expectations for earnings growth for the remainder of this year.
Okay, you mentioned the Philippines a few weeks ago, I think a month ago, in an interview you said the Philippines presented very good opportunity because it has underperformed quite a bit. Well,
yes.
We've outperformed in the last 4 weeks of five, gone up, 10, 11% over the last month.
Yeah.
What's your take? What's your stand on the Philippine market today, where it is? We've gone up by so much.
That's a good question. I mean, a month ago, we were looking at this as a much better opportunity and a much better entry point. Right now, there are still opportunities within the Philippines, but now we're probably, I would say, a bit more neutral. But with that said, when you look at some of the positives, for instance, if you look at still some of the conglomerates that are out there, I would say that focus on more of the conglomerates with specifically more of the consumer focus, SM, LT Groups, these guys with a large consumer sort of business, that they're going to be the business that recovers quickly, right? The fact is that if we start to see, let's say, the Metro Manila area opening up, we see specifically that, with the vaccine shots now above 10 million, well, still well below the herd immunity rate of 70 million, right? But at least, you're gradually getting there. We're seeing specifically, overall overseas remittance continue to be on a positive, from a lot of different areas around Asia, as well as from North America as well. So those things point in the right direction, I would say, in particular for the Philippine markets. But we want to take a bit of a breather now. If you look at on a year-to-date basis, despite this 10+% gain that we've seen over the past month, for the full year, for the year-to-date number, we're still kind of flat, sort of down a couple percent, for the market. So it'll be interesting to see what happens in the second half. But if all signs are pointing in the right direction, there can be still, further legs up. But, we probably be a bit more careful now as compared to what we were, I would say, 4 weeks ago.
And for foreign investors, are we looking particularly attractive? Because we did start to see hot money flow back into the Philippines. A lot of the foreign funds that have been selling us out have finally bought back in. Do you think that's sustainable?
That is one of those things where, because, you know, we start to see foreigners starting to pull out, but then more recently, when you look at the foreign investments, you know, they have creeped them, you know, they've creeped in quite a bit. So it is of note, you know, and this is going to be something worthwhile to see. And also whether or not, you know, sort of where we are at with the pesos, because the fact is that, you know, more recently, we've seen a bit more of a decline in the peso, while over the past couple of years, we've been seeing strong increases. So, you know, we need to also see, you know, specifically with the with the reserves that Philippines have, and when we look at the balance of payments in the Philippines, you know, what's going to happen there? You know, the surplus for balance of payments might not be as high as what was expected earlier this year. And if that continues to decline, and let's say, you know, some of these international reserves have to be used up a bit, that potentially might be might not be a strong support for the peso, at least in the short term. So these are all things that a lot of investors will have to continue to see.
Okay, so big picture now, Ken, it's end of the month, the last day of June. We're starting a brand new month in quarter July. What is it typically a good month? Where do you see smart money flowing into?
Yeah, there's a few things that we're looking at right now. For instance, for tonight, you know, in the U.S., you know, we have this large Chinese IPO with Didi going through with their IPO. Didi is China's version of Uber, and you know, they've done very well within China. There's a lot of institutional retail investor demand for this particular stock. So we are definitely still seeing a bit of attractiveness in some of these new stocks coming online. Again, we have to realize that it is the summer months. You know, in July in particular, you do tend to see a lot of people potentially taking vacations, especially with a lot of people not being able to take vacations last year. This year in places like North America, as well as in Europe, we do see some people maybe taking a bit of a break, and potentially that could lead to a slighter decline in terms of trading volumes. But with that said, again, you know, everybody's connected very well, you know, in terms of, you know, sort of technology. And so even if they are on break, they're still able to, you know, trade stocks. But, you know, I would say right now, a lot of eyes are right now going to be focusing on, you know, the first half earnings. As you mentioned earlier, you know, end of the month, end of the quarter, end of the first half, with companies now, you know, gradually starting to report their numbers, you know, all ours are going to be on the guidance, you know, what's going to happen over the next 6 months, you know, into the second half of 2021, where are companies expecting to see, you know, sort of growth areas, and whether or not, you know, the growth that they saw during the first half of 2021, is that going to be sustainable in the second half, especially with all these, you know, sort of short-term concerns over some of these lockdowns.
Final question, Ken, for the investor out there or the trader who are watching us, what should smart investors pay attention to? I know it's always a challenge to separate the signals from the noise. We do hear a lot of noise. So what would you say are the signals and what would be noise at this point? I imagine signal would be the earnings.
Yeah, it's signals are definitely earnings. You know, not looking at very short-term sort of, like you mentioned earlier, market noise. I mean, for us, being a bottom-up investor, our focus much more is going to be sort of on sustainable earnings growth. You know, at Eastspring, our focus very much is, you know, not only what's happening over the next quarter or two, but over the next couple of years. You know, even if companies reported a fairly disappointing first quarter, second quarter, or first half of 2021, if specifically, you know, they have a plan in place where, you know, over the next couple of years, they're going to see strong revival in earnings growth, those are more important aspects. Because the fact is that if you've already had the short-term market noise impacting the share price, it's already impacted, you know, the stock. And so as a result, you know, there's no point sort of just doing this short-term trading. But the focus is whether or not this company can actually see a recovery. And sometimes, you know, companies might have had a disappointing first quarter, first half, not necessarily by its own doing, but because of market conditions, like what happened with COVID and potentially with some of the shutdowns in the economy. But if the company has a plan and if things starts to normalize, and if then we can start to see, you know, earnings really grow significantly as a result, that are, you know, these are really key signs for us when it comes to looking for companies.
Okay, Ken, thank you so much for joining us this morning on The Insights. Looking forward to speaking with you again.
My pleasure.